completely free. Call now.
Welcome back to Daytona, and as you can see, the grandstands are very nicely filled. Thank you very much for the Daytona Supercross by Honda. As we have now one more race remaining prior to the mains, here are the results from semi number two. Isaiah Johnson with a nice run over hole shot leader Damian Plotz, Campbell Mason, Karsten, and Jimmy Wilson all getting in. And so they are in the main event. Three more will come out of the last chance qualifier. Let's go downstairs. Jamie Little as our winner.
Isaiah, I'll tell you what, you've been improving every week. It finally came together for you.
Yeah, I had a little trouble in my heat race. I went down over there while I was in fifth, and I just wanted to come back in that semi and put in some good laps because my heat race were a little tight, and I just want to make at least 20 good laps in the main, but if I get lapped, then it's no big deal, and I'll just keep on charging.
How'd you finally get around Damian Plotz?
He actually made some mistakes over on the rhythm section before the finish line, but my Bill's Pipe Pro Caliber Suzuki was working real good out there. RG3 had my suspension really dialed in, and I felt good. I mean, all my sponsors are behind me, so hopefully I can put in a consistent main event, because that's what it's going to be all about, not getting on the ground.
All right, Isaiah, congratulations. Great job.
Thanks. I'd also like to thank Pro Caliber, Sunstar Sprockets, everyone else for helping me out, Pro Grip, and MR2 Helmets, just everyone doing a great job, and my dad for helping me out with my mechanic.
All right, back to you guys.
Well, thank you very much. While Jamie was interviewing our most recent winner, Rick, we voted on the most entertaining race of the day so far. And you know, with all due respect to the guys who went out there in the qualifiers, we've got to give the most entertaining race award, at least from up here in the booth, to Nathan Ramsey. And with that in mind, let's take another look at
Nathan's
day.
Take a look at this, Nathan Ramsey, who's coming off a broken collarbone, gets the hole shot, gets out in front. He's looking, everything looking good. He's on that factory 450 Honda. Gets passed by Tyler Evans, then gets passed again, makes his way back out into the front. So he's got the hole shot, then he gets passed, he's back into the lead, then he goes into this little left-hand turn, hooks up, tips over, doesn't stall, it keeps it running, but was able to catch back up to Krein, pass him one more time, same corner, hooks up, now he stalls the bike. But in three kicks, he gets the thing going and back on his way. Now he gets back up to Krein, makes a move, goes to the outside and carries that momentum to the four stroke back into the lead. So Nathan Ramsey, they don't call him the dog for anything. Very, very impressive and very strong for a guy who's dealing with a hurt shoulder.
So Nathan Ramsey with our most entertaining race of the day of the three qualifiers, the two semis so far. They're doing some more maintenance watering down the track. We got one more race and then the mains here at Daytona live on Speed.
New scent from Speed Stick.
Cool.
Inspired by the power of nature. Protection that smells good.
Godlike.
Last time, he fought against his sworn enemies.
Stop!
This time, he will fight with them.
We're offering you a truce.
To destroy a new breed of terror.
You want me to hunt them for you?
Come on, they're all freaks.
Not know who you are
messing with.
Wesley Snipes, Blade 2, rated R. Starts Friday, March 22nd.
If you have a tax problem or owe money to the IRS, please stay tuned for some important information. The IRS is now reconciling back owed taxes, liens, levies, payroll taxes, even penalties. If you act now, the Seidemann Law Firm can settle your IRS debt for just pennies on the dollar. Don't wait until it's too late. Call the Seidemann Law Firm now and settle your IRS problems for only pennies on the dollar. Don't be another IRS victim. Call today for a free confidential tax analysis.
Call toll-free now, 1-800-391-4499.
Thank you.
Welcome back once again to Daytona International Speedway for Supercross Live. And we welcome you. I'm Brian Drever along with Rick Johnson, Greg White downstairs, Jamie Little, Dave Despain on the set. I mean, we've got a cast of thousands here, and that is just today. You can look forward to Monday night at 7 p.m. where Michael Waltrip, Johnny Benson, and Ken Schrader, some of your new four-wheel buddies, will recap past weekend's events from the Craftsman Truck to Winston Cup Racing on NASCAR Inside Winston Cup. Tune in right here on Speed for all your four-wheel action after you enjoy a great two-wheeled weekend here during Bike Week at Daytona. So as the track continues to be maintained, we're already starting to look forward to those main events, which of course will begin with the 125 main and then the 250 main. And a lot of the fans in the stands here, of course, are Jeremy McGrath fans. That he carried the sport of Supercross on his back for so long. He has had a couple of seasons that have not really turned out for him the way that he might have wanted to, but he still is out there trying to pursue an eighth championship. We visited with Jeremy a little bit early and got his thoughts on this season.
I'm dealing with it, trying to keep my head up. I'm not going to quit. I feel that, I mean, over this past summer and break for me, I worked my ass off, and I've worked harder than I ever have in my life. And to be shut down, you know, physically is, you know, kind of hard. So it's been tough. What I had to do, I think, is just take a break. I haven't really ridden my motorcycle in over a month until this week. I practiced this week, and my left arm seems to be good now, and my right arm still give me a little trouble, but I think it's just a matter of time, you know? The long-term goal of having another title this year is way out of reach, and, you know, I got to just focus on my short-term goals, worry about each week, try and keep my body in as good health as I can. And try and get out there, get hole shots, try and lead the race. And, you know, I want to win a few races before the year's up, for sure. I want to win the title. I wanted to win the title. And it's going to make next year really good because, you know, for the most part, everyone's kind of written me off a little bit. And, you know, he's old now and all this stuff. But, you know, believe it or not, I still want to win as much or more than I ever have. And, you know, riding around in six is not the place for me. I don't like it, and I'm not happy about it. And I want to win. I want to give Bud Light and Yamaha some wins, and that's the goal. I've considered retiring at times, you know, like especially last year, get beat every week, and it wasn't really fun. And this is a whole new challenge, you know, riding around in sixth. It's kind of not been fun. And say that happens next year, yeah, that's it.
Pretty hard words, man. When you got a guy who's dominated the sport, I mean, I had a short reign of domination. Nothing compared. I mean, you could put myself, Bob Hanna, who's ever third and fourth, all together, put all of our wins together. I don't think we come close to Jeremy McGrath. And when you got a guy who is, like you say, dominated, I mean, not just won races, but dominated the sport for the past 5 years, he's not gonna take a beating for long.
You aren't far from wrong. With 72 wins, Jeremy McGrath is head and shoulders above the rest, with all due respect, Rick Johnson. And he remains the favorite of so many fans here. You will hear a lot of cheering if Jeremy McGrath goes into the lead. That's a little further down the line. We're going to take another quick break and return live to Daytona.
They asked me how I knew my true love was true. Oh, when your heart's on fire, you must realize smoke gets in your eyes.
The new Roadster Warrior, 102 cubic inches of raw burning love.
Smoke gets in your eyes.
From the makers of Tony Hawk's Pro Skater comes Sean Palmer's Pro Snowboarder, where you can trick off of everything on the mountain.
Yeah, just like in the real world.
Ride 8 different real world mountains. Choose from 10 top boarders, including Salt Lake gold medalist Ross Powers. Pull insane combos and trick off of everything.
Yeah, everything.
Sean Palmer's Pro Snowboarder. Rated E for everyone.
This is Silverado Heavy Duty, with the most towing capacity of any heavy-duty pickup. Silverado Heavy Duty. More truck. From Chevy.
To think there's a buzz all over America about Speed's unprecedented 11 hours of live coverage from Bike Week here in Daytona. Began yesterday with a very fine 750 and 600 race, and then it's going to continue tomorrow morning with live GP racing and the Daytona 200 via Rai in the afternoon, all live. But if you miss any of that, don't forget you can tune in Bike Week Two Wheel Tuesday at 7 p.m. Oh, and that reminds me, the host of Bike Week, Dave Despain, is here. Dave.
Yes, indeed, Trevor, and I'm always happy to come to Daytona because I see so many old friends, and once in a while you're lucky, they bring along their photo album. Let me show you some very cool pictures here. 20-year-old Jim Pomeroy as a Bultaco factory rider. He rode the very first Supercross at Daytona, 1972. That was 31 years ago. He's exhausted. Not so much because of the race, but because he just flew in from Spain. He's jet-lagged. A year later in Spain, history. You're going to need a spotlight to find Pomeroy in a field that includes Mikkola, Vial, Everts, Moiseev, Gabors, Meisch, and Robert, to name just a few. You did not need a spotlight to find Jim Pomeroy at the end of the race. He won it. He became the first American ever to win a GP. Not only that, he was the first guy ever to win any kind of GP at all in his first try. And he's loving looking at that photograph, ladies and gentlemen, all these years later. Jim Pomeroy, man, good to see you back here at Daytona. Yeah. What did that feel like? That must have been a thrill of a lifetime.
Oh, it was unexpected, totally.
Yeah.
I mean, no American had ever been in the top 10 in any moto.
Right.
So it just, it was a thrill.
You're more nervous right now than you were back then. Don't you try to fool me. You've spent your whole life, you had a normal life like everybody else, you know, have a family and all the rest of that. And then out of the blue, you get elected to the Motorcycle Hall of Fame. And all of a sudden your phone starts ringing. And now you're a hero again. And you're just loving it, aren't you?
Oh, it's a dream come true. I can't even explain it.
Yeah.
It's overwhelming for me.
You got your Spanish Motorcycle Owners Group smog hat on. You're going back to Spain. Tell me about that.
A couple weeks ago, I got called from the Bultaco Club in Barcelona, and the president of the club, and they're going to have the first Grand Prix, which they're actually going to have it for the 125s, 250s, and 500s. And I'm going to be the Grand Marshal and ride my 1976 GP bike around before each one.
He was the guest of honor and speaker this morning at the Hall of Fame breakfast to raise money for the museum. The goal was $25,000. How'd you do?
A little over $35,000.
$35,000, and he got a standing ovation. I love seeing you back here and having so much fun. I know what a thrill this is for you. Thanks for stopping by, man.
Thank you very much.
Jim Pomeroy, winner of the 1973 Spanish Grand Prix on a Bultaco. That's what that thumbs up's all about. We'll take a commercial break and be back with more in Daytona.
Godlights.
Last time, he fought against his sworn enemies.
Stop!
This time, he will fight with them.
You're offering your truth.
To destroy a new breed of terror.
You want me to hunt them for you?
Come on, they're all freaks.
Not know who you are
messing with!
Wesley Snipes. Blade 2. Rated R. Starts Friday, March 22nd.
Motorcycles live on speed. No one gets you closer.
You may know me on TV as the spokesman for Guarantee Trust Life, but here outside work, I have a family of my own and real life insurance needs just like you. That's why when I tell you about GTL on TV, it just makes good sense that the people you love aren't burdened by the debts, expenses, or credit accounts that could be left behind when you're no longer with them. The Lifetime Plan is $10,000 of term life insurance protection that's guaranteed renewable for life with guaranteed affordable rates. The benefits can never be reduced, and the money will be paid directly to your beneficiary tax-free. Sure, I've enjoyed telling you about GTL. It's my job. But if you're like me, back home, you still want the most out of life for your wife or husband, your children. Maybe you even have grandkids. So go ahead, get started today by calling for your free information kit. Get the most out of life. Guarantee Trust Life.
Call 1-800-672-6363 for your free information kit. That's 1-800-672-6363.
From high above Daytona International Speedway, you're looking at the starting gate for the last chance qualifier in the 250 class. So three more riders have a chance, Rick Johnson, to get into the main. They're getting ready to go. The goggles are on. The bikes are in gear, the gate's about to drop, and this is the final opportunity to get into the big show.
Yeah, this is the last chance. A lot of these guys have ridden all day long. They were in the prelim heats, and now they're having to run again. We have a pileup in the first turn, but a lot of guys making it through clean.
I think Ty Wallace on the 83 bike got the hole shot. We'll have a look. Yes, that's him out in front. And indeed, there are three bikes and three riders whose day has ended much earlier than they wanted to get to.
Ty Wallace and Bruce Stratton are 1 and 2. But if you notice, these riders don't quite hit it with the same pizzazz as Ricky Carmichael. For one, nothing against them, but they've been riding all day long. They got up at 6 o'clock to make it to the track. They've had to run the practice. They had to run the heat races just to get into the heat races, and then one more qualifiers and semis, and now the last chance. So these guys have had a long day this far, and those top couple guys are going to make it to the main.
I'm going to one up a little bit on that. Some of these fellas don't have the benefit of a big factory team that drives the hauler in, puts the bikes together, and set it up. A lot of these fellas got here last night, drove in, found their pit stall, or a spot to camp in, probably fell asleep in the back seat of their van, and then got up at 6 o'clock this morning.
Well, yeah, that's the way, you know, these guys, the privateers, have to make it. And you look at the guys like Jimmy Pomeroy. I mean, I have the world of respect for the guys that laid down the framework for me to make a living and put some money in the bank when I was racing professional motocross.
Fast
for the lead right there.
Orloff went around. Joe Orloff from Ohio.
Joseph Orloff's got a really good run going. And looks like he's running the four stroke, so he's got a little bit, you know, it's easier on you. If you flow with the track, it doesn't beat you up as bad. It doesn't have that hard hitting power like the two strokes do. But a lot of the top guys like the two strokes because they can ride it on that edge.
Orloff came from fourth across start finish line after the gate fell to lead this race. So Joseph Orloff looking good for his opportunity to get into the main event through the last chance qualifier. He's riding a Yamaha.
Orloff is on a Honda, and Ty Wallace on a Yamaha. So we got a whole variety of brands here. And then
190 bike, Caton.
Caton is on a Suzuki, so we got a full variety. But this track is just brutal on rider and machine. You know, Gary Bailey's been doing a great job going out and prepping the track in between each heat race. And when we get a little bit of a break for track maintenance, they get about 5 minutes, and they run out there with tractors, and he's basically the Oregon rider. Guy's going, whoa!
Problem!
And Ty Wallace going down really, really hard. He cased that jump, and it blew his pegs off the back, and then around he went. Really, really hard hit.
I think his air went somewhere else.
Yeah, well, it's not just his hair. You know, I've had it happen to me quite a few times. Your body smashes onto the bike. You see, he comes up completely short, then off the back, and then his lower extremities and his chest gets smashed onto the handlebars, and so it completely knocks the wind out of you. And if anybody that's ever been kicked knows what we're talking about, right there, really,
yeah,
really hard hit, and we don't want to make light of anybody crashing like that, but it is a tough hit. But look, man, the guy gets back up, and it's natural instinct for them to get back on their feet and try to get going, but right now he's just trying to catch his breath and make sure he's okay.
Well, they're checking him out over there at trackside right now. He was running in second position and was our whole shot leader. Ty Wallace from Phoenixville, Pennsylvania on a Sussex Motorsports Yamaha. And that has left a pretty clear track for our new leader, Joseph Olaf, who took the lead away from Wallace and has been untouched ever since. He's opened up, well, better than a 2 second gap. 1.8 seconds at start finish line last time. I guarantee when he goes across the line now, he'll have a lot more than that.
But Clark Stiles has moved into second place and is running very strong. He's staying right with Olaf. If Olaf makes a mistake, Stiles will be right on top of him. We're seeing the halfway flags. That's where you see the flagman with the cross flags, just to let you people that aren't in the sport know. That's where they're letting the rider know we're halfway through this race.
Halfway through with two laps to go. So there is your leader, Joe Olaf. Yeah, the fastest lap is indeed by Stiles, who is coming up from apparently a start that didn't really work out all that well for him. Set the fastest lap of the race at 1:39. Now that compares to the fastest lap for Travis Pastrana of 1:28.
This is a brutal straightaway. We see Olaf bouncing side by side, and then onto Stiles in second, but look how hard he lands off of this triple jump. You can't quite see it at that angle, but Stiles has got a very strong rhythm, and Clark is moving along and using quite a bit of the track, so he's got time to relax and to think about what's going on. He can watch what Olaf is doing in front of him, and he's not worried about somebody pushing on him from behind, so he's in a good position.
In the third and final transfer position is Mike Caton Jr. out of East Sparta, Ohio. We're not looking at him right now. Instead, we're watching the second place rider who came up from a pretty bad start to get where he is right now. Clark Stiles out of Athens, Alabama, Sergeant Yamaha.
Yeah, I haven't seen Stiles in a lot of the races, but he seems to be strong. You know, he's just riding consistent now because these guys, I'll bet most of them have blisters on their hands. You can't imagine how rough it is. You're getting sand thrown in your face, down your pants. I mean, you are completely worked after a day at Daytona. And a lot of times I didn't have to run the semi in the last chance. I just knew how bad it was running practice, qualifier, and the main event. So these guys are definitely the Ironman of motocross.
White flag coming up for our leader, Joe Orloff. And we alluded to a little bit. You showed us the dirt clod, the rock, the grass. The track is really starting to deteriorate, especially the kind of sandy sections, because sand isn't a very stable building material. We know that all the talk about houses built on sand, etc. But the track has really changed from this morning.
Yeah, you look at the really bright green grass. That used to be just a flat, smooth grass straightaway, almost like a golf course that we're watching Caton go around. But it deteriorates and gets down into that sand, and it gets deeper and deeper and deeper. So this is the first taste of what nationals are. Back in the 80s and early 90s, they used to run a week before this race at the first national in Gainesville, but now they got the series separated where the first part of the season is Supercross, the second part is national. But that was always a good prelim for the Daytona Supercross, because now you had to deal with speed and 2 30-minute motos, and so you had a lot of things to help you get ready. Now you're just thrown right to the fire.
We're looking at the number 53 bike, and that is Clark Stiles running in second position. We watched for a while the 190 of Mike Caton Jr., and now we go back to the leader of this race, and that is Joseph Olaf, who made a pass on the lead, and then the 83 bike of Ty Wallace had such a misfortune there. We hope he's all right, and we think he is. He's been moved away from where he was before, and perhaps his air came back again.
Yeah, amongst other things. And look at this, you know, to go back to what I was saying earlier about Jimmy Pomeroy and stuff, the guys that paved the way, they mentioned all that, but here Olaf goes into the main event. I'll get back to that later.
Checkered flag for Joseph Olaf. We'll hear from him when we come back. He had a pretty quiet ride considering now he's in the main event.
What is the ultimate race place? On the weekend of April 5th through 7th, there'll be a new twist as the gladiators of the AMA Yamaha Superbike Challenge debut on California Speedway's all-new state-of-the-art motorcycle road course. Experience the speed and the fury. Order your tickets now at californiaspeedway.com or call 1-800-944-RACE. California Speedway, America's ultimate race place. Behold the hot and juicy Whopper, flame broiled, never fried. crisp lettuce, crunchy dill pickles, onions, and red ripe tomatoes on a freshly baked bun. America's favorite burger just keeps getting better. Aren't you hungry for a Whopper now?
How does lightning smell? Smell this.
Lightning. An intense new scent from Speedstick.
Nice.
Inspired by the power of nature. Protection that smells good.
From the makers of Tony Hawk's Pro Skater comes Sean Palmer's Pro Snowboarder, where Sean and nine top pros, including Salt Lake gold medalist Ross Powers, trick off of everything.
Yeah, everything.
Sean Palmer's Pro Snowboarder. Rated everyone.
It's time to spring into action at your Honda dealer. Spring into the saddle of selected CRs or XRs and ride off with 6.9% financing and no down payment. And you can also get 6.9% and no down payment on any Honda ATV. Or if you'd rather spring for low monthly payments, they start as low as $69 a month with your Honda card. Spring into action now on dirt bikes and ATVs at your Honda dealer.
A few moments ago, as Joe Olam crossed the start-finish line, it appears that the entire town of Wapakoneta, Ohio, has showed up here at Daytona International, and they brought their signs, and clearly the education system there in town is doing very well. They didn't transpose anything. They got it all right. Go, Joe. Go, Olam, number 79. Let's go downstairs to Jamie Little, who's with the honoree.
Thanks a lot. That was my question. Joe, I know you're from Ohio, but where'd all these people come from? You brought a whole fan section with you.
Yeah, I stayed down here the past couple weeks with a couple buddies of mine, and they said they were going to do something special for me, and I didn't know what to expect, but they said to look up in the stands when I got on the gate, and they definitely surprised me, so that's pretty cool.
You've already had to race three times since the show began today. Are you going to be able to hang in there for the main?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, this track's so tough. You just got to get in a good pace and, you know, try to stay consistent the whole race. I didn't want to do it this way, but sometimes you got to do what you got to do.
Good job, Joe. We'll see you in the main.
Thanks a lot. I'd like to thank all my sponsors, and thanks my girlfriend. I know she's watching at home, so thanks for everything, and thank my sponsors.
Back to you guys.
Okay, let's go now to Greg White with a report on the track and how it is holding up.
Well, Brian, I'm standing on the front straightaway side whoops, and it is a sea, an absolute sea of dirt. It goes up and down and all sides. This place is absolutely crazy. You saw Ricky Carmichael crash here earlier. Well, things are so hectic down here that nobody can even hold a straight line right through this whoop section. The fast guys are all the way over to the left side of the track. That's the only way you're going to get through this section. You could lose a lot of time here, Brian.
Well, we've seen it, and Rick Johnson, your assessment of how the track has changed, and of course, whoop sections are really where disaster, I think, can bite you quicker than anywhere else.
Well, typically in Supercross, that's true, and more so here because it's more of just the track getting rougher and rougher. Whoops, in a typical Supercross, they're at the worst at the beginning. Now here, you can see the grooves and not just the sand. It's the grooves that throw the riders off because your back wheel's trying to find its line, and your front wheel's bouncing from bump to bump, and those little lines that you see in there can throw a man on the ground. We've seen it happen to Ricky Carmichael, who is at this day the best rider in the world. So it happens to the best of them, and he's a talented sand rider. So there's a whole group of things that can mess you up when it comes to riding in Florida. Carmichael has the right combination, but it still bit him.
There you can see the depth of some of the grooves, and I can imagine that if your front wheel, as you say, the rear wheel's looking for traction, the front wheel's trying to find the top of the bumps. If they get in different grooves, that's what spits you sideways,
spits
and we saw
sideways.
That happen too.
Exactly, and the thing that typically on whoops, what you try to do is get on top, but the way the nature of motorcycles and the throttle and the rear wheel spaces them out that they can't get on top of them. They have to wheelie through each one.
And our cameraman, Brad Jones, walking through there is trying to make sure he puts one foot in each of those grooves. Thanks a lot, Jonesy. We'll be back here to Daytona International in just a minute. The only order of business now, main events.
Everyone makes to-do lists. Some are just more ambitious than others. Ready to make your list for 2002? Start by visiting your local Kawasaki dealer today and get zero down, zero interest, and zero payments on any Kawasaki vehicle until 2003.
All I need.
knows all I need.
I've got a brand new grandson.
I still have a younger brother in college. I email him a lot.
Very easy to use.
Instant messages are amazing.
I love hearing.
You've got mail.
AOL is really quick.
America Online has new music.
I feel like a part of a community with AOL.
She's always on AOL.
Customer service has been superb.
I love AOL.
America Online, so easy to use, no wonder it's number one. Call 1-800-4-ONLINE.
Poor old furniture. But now you can restore and renew all your favorite furniture and woodwork with professional results in seconds with Trade Secret. Because finally, the secret is out. Just pour the concentrated scratch remover onto a clean cloth, rub it in, and the scratches disappear. Even scratches like this disappear instantly. And Trade Secret is safe on any finish, even your finest antiques. So don't ignore it. Restore it with Trade Secret. Call now to get two Trade Secret scratch removers for one low price of just $19.95 for dark wood and light wood. Plus, you'll receive Trade Secret's concentrated 2-in-1 furniture polish and cleaner free. But wait, call in the next 10 minutes and we'll even include 4 professional fill sticks absolutely free, all for only $19.95. Trade Secret, you'll love the difference.
For rush delivery, use your credit card and call 1-800-698-4664 or send check or money order for $19.95 plus shipping and handling to the address on your screen. The secret is out, so call now.
Motorsports live on speed, and anything that has an engine and a few things that don't are what you can see here on Speed, the most comprehensive motorsports program on television. Speed News every Sunday at 9 p.m. Eastern Time provides highlights and results from events worldwide and features fans can't find anywhere else. There is so much action here on Speed that you got to stay up 24 hours a day. So the riders in the 125 class have gone out to have a look at the track because it's been a while since the qualifiers for these riders, and there has been a lot of, well, for lack of a better word, deterioration. Let's just say that the racetrack here at Daytona International has been amended somewhat since we began.
Yeah, that's right, Brian. What happens is a lot of these guys have went back taking naps, and they haven't had to do much, just relax and get ready for the main event. But the track, like you say, has deteriorated in a lot of cases where it's soft sand. We looked at those grooves, but then Gary Bailey goes out with his tractor crew and patches up the jumps that where they were getting broken down in the whoops, where there's a lot of lines and stuff. They'll fix that up, not to make it easier for the riders, but it makes for better racing the first couple laps when you have guys 4 and 5 abreast all racing for one position. If they're stuck with a groove, a lot of times it makes for a lot of guys falling.
We'll take a look at the starting lineup for the 125. Langston and Reed, and then Mike Brown and Schnell. So in Boniface, I mean, Langston had choice there. It's going to be interesting to see where he lines up. So these are the first 10 riders in the starting grid for the 125 main event.
But Grant Langston getting that number one spot because he was the fastest qualifier.
Chad Reed had a pretty easy qualifying heat. Those are the top 10. We'll show you the rest of them as they continue to look at the racetrack here and get ready for the main event in the 125. You get ready. It's coming right up.
I walked 47 miles of barbed wire. I got a cobra snake for a necktie. A brand new house out on the roadside. And it's a letter to rattlesnake pie.
So, you know that stuff I was sealing the cracks in my house with the other day?
Yeah, great stuff. You told me.
Yeah, so it lasts for years.
No kidding.
Shh. It's awesome. It's easy to use. You can seal up the whole house without even breaking a sweat. And oh man, does it ever save on the heating and AC bills. Ah, there she is.
Oh, you're actually gonna fish today?
Great stuff. It's great.
Oh yeah. What's with this guy?
Hey, lots of lake, buddy.
Maybe he'd like to hear about the cracks in your house.
the pickles, hold the lettuce. Special orders now, you know they don't upset us.
I gotta get a Whopper.
You got it.
Hi, I'm Paul Tracy. If you don't have a hangover from Saturday night, check out Kart Live on Sunday.
Welcome back to Daytona International for Supercross. But coming up, we've got Formula One. Will Ferrari unveil its 2002 car in Malaysia? Find out as Speed Channel begins its live coverage of the Malaysian Grand Prix with Formula One practice Thursday night at 12 a.m. Eastern Time. TV Tune Speed for all Formula One action all season long. Quick look at the riders lined up for the 125 main. And once again, a look at the top 10 riders. Grant Langston and Chad Reed, the winners of the qualifiers. And it'll be interesting to see exactly where they line up. What is equally interesting here at Daytona International is that for the first time, or it is truly an international event, there are five different countries represented in the main. The USA, France, Australia, South Africa, and Canada. And in the 17 years this race has been held here, only twice has it been won by non-Americans.
Okay, the 30-second board is up, and then you've heard a lot of information about the young black man from Florida named Bubba Stewart, James Bubba Stewart. He runs the West Coast, and that's why he's not out here. He's leading the points on the West Coast Supercross Series in the 125, and so he's not able to run like Billy Lanovich is here. So,
and he's from Florida.
He's from Florida, which is tough.
That's a little weird.
The West Coast is a tough series, and he's doing a great job there for Kawasaki.
Hey, the San Francisco 49ers are in the Eastern Division. Here we go, ready to go with a 125 main, 15 laps live on Speed, and it's coming right at you.
Through that first turn is Chad Reed and Grant Langston. This is the race that we've been looking for. Langston around the second turn first with Chad Reed, and here comes Mike Brown. So here we got the three tough contenders right now with Langston first and Brown second. This is the dice that they had for the 125 championship, but once again, Chad Reed sits back, relaxes, but get ready to watch him pounce.
Into fourth position right now. Up front, though, it is Langston Brown, then Reed in third, Boniface in fourth on the other KTM, Larry Ward in fifth position. So your leader is Grant Langston on the KTM. Rider number 111, winner of the fastest heat. Apparently his choice of start gate position worked out pretty well. Obviously, he gets a good hole shot.
Right, he got a great hole shot. That's what we were talking earlier about, the difference between the two-stroke and the four-stroke. But Grant Langston on this KTM two-stroke 125, as they've said, that puts out the most horsepower of any 125. So this big track in the sand, that KTM power is going to come in handy.
Langston out in front with a pretty good lead. In second position, it's Mike Brown on the Kawasaki. Bright green and with a number three on it. Brown trying to make up some ground. And as they'll come across the start-finish line for the first time after a full lap, we get the full rundown of who's where and by how much.
With the track conditions being so inconsistent, meaning that the dirt is soft, that's where you see the guys get spread out the first lap. In Supercross, typically on the indoor circuits, everything is groomed, it's clay, it's hard, and it's very consistent, so the riders all stay very close. But you can come into a corner here at Daytona, lose the front wheel, and lose 4 to 5 bike lengths in one turn, but you can also make it back. That's what makes the racing so great. But Langston, very strong out in front.
Langston leads by about a triple jump over Mike Brown, who leads by about the same margin over Chad Reed, who leads Boniface by about the same margin. So the front four, make it five, are really spread out pretty evenly. In fifth place, it is Larry Ward.
Yeah, Larry Ward's doing a good job just sitting back and riding. Now he needs to start making some ground because you don't want to lose track of those leaders. Once they get out in front, you don't want to lose them.
Langston is your leader.
Unbelievable. We're looking at lap times here. Grant Langston did a 1:29, the same lap time as Ricky Carmichael did in his 250 heat race. So that tells you, one, how fast the rider is, two, how strong that KTM 125 is. For him to put that kind of lap in, which it won't stay that way because the track's going to deteriorate more, but Grant is putting together a great race.
But my first question would be, is the track any faster because of how it deteriorated in terms of the clock?
A little bit, but you know, Langston is putting a great ride together. These three riders you can throw a blanket over are the three best 125 Supercross riders in the East Coast region. Yeah, we got one from Australia, one from South Africa, and one from America, but these are the guys that fought for the 125 National Championship, and these are the guys that are leading the now 125 East Coast Supercross Championship.
Mike Brown in second position had closed up on Langston. Chad Reed has definitely closed up, and Larry Ward is out of the race.
Don't know what is wrong with Larry's bike, but he just seems to be pushing it. He's pretty disgusted. He hasn't taken his goggles off. It doesn't look like he wants to talk.
Chad Reed may have sized up the competition long enough, as now he's really making a move on Mike Brown because he sees Langston starting to get away. Brown is not able to close the gap. Reed wants to get up there and try to do it himself.
Well, Reed wants to get up there, but if you notice, I never really see desperation in Chad Reed. But when he rides, he just works on going faster. He doesn't get desperate. He knows he has a lot of time out there, and he can still see Langston and Brown in front of him, so he's not going to make any stupid mistakes or push it too hard. He's just going to let the speed come to him.
Lap 3 of 15. Plenty of time indeed, but Chad Reed seems to be sizing up Mike Brown right now for a pass.
Este is a little bit lower than Brown, and now he pulls up next to him, and now it looks like he gets a run and moves into second place. So Chad Reed, our series point leader, is now in second place.
Now, Chad Reed makes very little of the fact that he's on a four-stroke against the two-strokes, but it does seem to be that at certain parts of this racetrack, at least, and around the Supercross circuit, four-strokes definitely have an advantage.
Well, I don't know on total numbers, but when it comes to torque numbers, the four-stroke has a lot more than the two-stroke. Weight, Yamaha's done a great job developing that motor to where they are, but you know, both the 125 Yamaha and the 250 four-stroke Yamaha that you can run in the 125 class are right around the weight limit once you lighten them up just a little bit. So really, weight's not a factor, it's just motor.
Look at the 128 lap by Chad Reed, who puts one together in a big way, his best lap time, 128.8, and that's in the same range as Travis Pastrana on the 252
stroke.
That's right,
in the big board class. So that just shows you that these guys are not playing around. They're racing very hard, which is great to see, because a lot of times guys will come to Daytona and pace themselves a little bit, but not this group of riders right here. Langston and Reed and Brown are both hitting it as hard as they can.
Pretty evenly spaced among the three leaders. Chad Reed moved into second position. Can he catch Grant Langston? We'll let you know when we come back to Daytona.
Lives on speed. The cars are tuned. The field is set. The drivers are hungry. Who'll stand on top and who'll stand aside? The CART FedEx Championship Series live in Monterrey, Mexico. Sunday at 4, only on speed.
World Rally Championship. The Tour de Corse. Tight turns, sheer cliffs, and unforgiving asphalt. One wrong move could spell disaster. The Tour de Corse, exclusively on speed.
Critics across America have spoken. The best new mid-season drama isn't on ABC, CBS, NBC. It's on cable channel FX.
I don't judge other cops.
Mac is not a cop. He's Al Capone with a badge.
The single most talked about new series.
Vic fired that shot, didn't he?
No.
Vic needed him dead.
No.
It takes the grit and reality of a homicide or Sopranos to a whole nother level.
Your turn to play bad cop?
Good cop and bad cop left for the day.
I'm a different kind of cop.
The mid-season's best new show.
Anyone gets between those two is just going to end up with a hose full of piss running down his leg.
Television's best new drama.
Until now, I've tolerated you. Come near my men again. I'm going to lose patience.
I know what happened.
Don't miss the series that's too intense for network television.
You're the police!
The Shield. Premiering Tuesday, March 12th, only on FX.
Welcome back to Daytona International as Grant Langston has a bigger lead than he did while we were watching. Sorry, we have a little privilege here. While you were watching commercials, we were watching, and Chad Reed made a mistake and when he was right to the back wheel of Grant Langston. And now he's going to try to do it again.
Well, Brian, that's what we talked about this track. This Daytona track is tough, and that's what a lot of riders like about it. But you can lose so much ground. Chad Reed was right on Grant Langston's rear fender, which he's almost there again, and he lost four bike lengths in one turn, but now he seemed to pull it right back in. That's the beauty of this track, is that you can make it or break it in one turn.
And Mike Brown hanging in there in third position. The race is really in first, second, and third. Fourth place is 21 seconds behind third. So this is the race right here, and it is a good one. Grant Langston has been holding on to the lead since the beginning. Chad Reed came up to move into second position. He moved up to the rear fender of Langston, and now he's having to do it again. Langston is just not going to lay down for Chad Reed at all.
No. Langston's not going to lay down for anybody. He's a very hard-headed racer who keeps his nose to the grindstone. And even if Chad Reed gets him and passes him, I do not expect Langston to lay down. He'll come back, he'll make another charge, so we could see a race right to the finish. With these three riders back-to-back, Mike Brown, if he wants a chance at this championship against Reed, he's got to be able to come back. So pretty soon we're going to see fitness play a big part in Supercross here at Daytona.
Chad Reed stalking Grant Langston, but Langston just does not want to consider, you know, slowing down or doing anything. He has not made one single tiny little error even to allow Reed to close up. Reed has done what he's done on talent, but Langston has matched him talent for talent all the way around this track so far. We're inside 10 laps to go.
Well, we look at the rhythm section of this track, and you got the double jumps and the tabletops and the different things, but it's the sand berms and the whoops that make up this race. With those soft sand whoops, and as you're going side to side, you can hear that the riders can't blitz them wide open. So that's going to be the make or break on who's probably going to win this race.
Now Mike Brown seems to have found a little bit of a new lease on life as he has come up to close the gap. One, two, three are right together, covered by less than 2 seconds.
Well, you look at Brown's trying some different lines. He's moving side to side, trying some different things, which he's in a good spot because right now, Reed has to focus on passing Langston, and Langston has to concentrate on keeping Reed behind him. So Brown's in a great position. If these two guys knock each other down, he could be the Cinderella story and run away with this.
Chad Reed comes right up behind Langston, and I think they almost made contact there. Might have slowed both of them down a little bit. Mike Brown trying to get up. It's Daytona. I'm going to say he's trying to get up the track.
He's trying to suck up onto his rear wheel. But then again, right now, Reed is pulled right back into the lane. So Reed needs to move off to the sides a little bit, which you see him. He's not running directly so he can avoid the roost for one, and then also if he makes a mistake. Now Reed takes it in a little deep, but Langston fought fine.
Reed takes the lead. A mistake. Langston goes into the bales.
Langston got hit and knocked Langston into the bales. Reed just retaliated. Langston started it and Reed bounced back and put him off the track.
Very, very big contact. Take another look at it.
We take a look at it. Reed goes to the outside. Langston looks over, does a little bit of a block pass, and then here comes Reed. Squares him up. I don't know. That wasn't intentional.
I don't think there was contact.
Reed was on the gas so hard that he started wheeling. He had his wheels turned to the left, but his momentum was carrying him to the right, and unfortunately for Grant Langston, that put him down.
I don't think there was. It didn't look like a lot of contact, but there was definitely interdiction. So Grant Langston, the former leader, has now relinquished that position over to Chad Reed. More when we return to Daytona.
Right now at your Yamaha dealer, every motorcycle, every ATV can be yours for only $49 per month at 3.99 APR. Plus, get up to $750 in free accessories on select models. See your local Yamaha dealer and get the Yamaha you want right now. Because a deal this good won't last forever.
Hey, tonight on Speed, it's all about CART. We've got CART qualifying at 8, then the Toyota Atlantic Series at 9:30. And I'm not going to lie to you, tonight it is a CART night. If you haven't seen CART lately, then I suggest you stick around. You will not be disappointed. Stay with us. It's all tonight on Speed.
NASCAR lives on speed. No one gets you closer.
Now, Cornerstone Promotions brings you Rockin' Instrumentals, featuring 34 of your all-time jukebox favorites. The songs that bring back magical memories. 34 original hits by the original artist together in this one great collection. Rockin' Instrumentals is not sold in stores. Here's how to order. Call this toll-free number now for Rockin' Instrumentals. Two cassettes, $19.98, two CDs, $26.98, plus $4.95 shipping. Have your credit card ready and call now.
Supercross lives on speed, and Chad Reed is your leader right now as he's moved out in front. You saw the incident with Grant Langston. Mike Brown, the beneficiary of that somewhat as well, as he's up into second place and pretty firmly in second place. It hurt Langston bad because he's dropped back 14 seconds behind Reed and 9 seconds behind Mike Brown. We're going to give you another look at it here.
Let's take another look at it. You see when it comes into play, you see these two riders coming down at both wide open speed, with Reed on the outside. Okay, as we get a look at that, we'll get that straightened out. But Reed's still out in front, very comfortable, very unbelievable condition. As we look at the lap times, he's only dropped 2 seconds from his fastest lap, was a 128. He's still at a 130, which is unbelievable for him to keep going as fast as the track deteriorates. He's running speeds that could run top five in the 250 class, people. So you gotta understand that this guy is flying. He looks very smooth, very confident, but he's still running unbelievably quick lap times.
Chad Reed on the number 103. And he just seems to be in another world out there as we see riders struggling, flopping around, you know, wrestling with their bikes, fighting every inch of the racetrack, and he gets his friend.
Yeah, but you see him getting there. He gets off the side of the rut a little bit. The bike wants to kick a little bit. He doesn't get too excited. He just works with it. If something throws him a curveball, he deals with it. He's not just set up to run just fast, just straight. He can deal with whatever gets thrown his way, and that's what's impressed me so much about him. And Mike Brown also, who hasn't done, hasn't been a real standout guy in Supercross, more of a national, because he is our defending 125 national champion, is still running strong. He's losing a little time on Reed, but he's staying in the points league, in the points race.
Reed with a 132 lap that time to Mike Brown's 133, so Brown is losing a second or two here and there, but he's still doing a great job. You saw the distance between Chad Reed and Mike Brown with two or three lap riders in between them right now. Each guy, though, just has to run his own race right now. There's really no side-by-side action or mano-a-mano going on. Meanwhile, we look a little deeper into the field, and here comes Grant Langston, who has closed up a little bit of ground, not a whole lot. We're still talking about an 8-9 second gap between second and third place.
Yeah, but Langston doesn't look like he's pushing it. You know, he was dealing with a sore shoulder. Hopefully he didn't hurt his shoulder with that crash, and he's not dealing with an injury right now. But he's not charging the corners the way he was earlier. Both of those riders were running 128s, between 128s and 130s, and now Grant's down to 134 or 133. So he's just not pushing as hard as he was, and we'll find out later why.
You can see the complete results scrolling across the top of your screen. Somewhat surprising considering his reputation. Buddy Antonez down in the 11th position.
Yeah, Buddy's not having a good run here in this main event, but you can see right there with Mike Brown landing really hard. The landing area is, what happens is that it gets really soft, and so when you land it, your wheels sink in, your cases collapse, and what happens is it wants to grab your bike and throw you over the handlebar. So you got to be conscious of that all the time. The bike's wanting to kick from side to side, but you got to make sure that you keep that thing moving forward always.
Mike Brown on the number three bike, just trying to maintain right now while Chad Reed is out in front. Reed taking advantage of, well, we talked about it with Grant Langston when in that turn, that Langston went in there and maybe just sort of over-defended or under-defended, not sure which you'd call it, got wide. They were on two very different lines. He opened the door for Reed. Reed went through, and unfortunately, it's stubbed Langston on the toe a little bit when it slammed shut.
And it's a shame because Grant has trained so hard. I'm friends with his trainer, Johnny Louch, and he's worked really hard with him over the winter. He had his both shoulders operated on. Here we get a look at it. Reed's on the outside. Langston moves out, but doesn't move out that far. Reed gets to square off the turn, gets on the gas a little bit sooner, and that's there. He starts to wheelie, and as he starts to bounce, they just hit a little bit. I don't think that Reed was trying to take him out, and if it were me, I think I would have tried to control Reed a little bit more in that corner. I think Langston was just riding his own line too much. He probably should have forced the issue a little bit harder.
Chad Reed just in another zone right now. Once he got into the lead, and it does, you know, his body language and his whole posture on the bike is so relaxed as he comes up behind the number 69 bike, and that is Andrew Short. Short is in ninth place, so he is about to put ninth place on down. He's already done, put him a lap down.
Yeah. Reed has... it's just smooth. Look at him. He keeps flowing. He keeps moving. He works with the bike. I look to this man to be one of the next superstars. I mean, which he's already a superstar in the 125 class, and he's been an unbelievably dominant champion when it comes to the Australian championships. But one of the big blocks for him to get over the top of was him and Jeremy McGrath collided in the Paris Supercross this year. Jeremy went down, Jeremy got flared up and really got into Chad's face, and Chad sort of thought, wow, I thought, you know, I did an interview with him, I thought he would have could handle that different, and he says, what it did to me was show that Jeremy McGrath is just a human. His father's always preached that. They're just human, they bleed, if they bleed, you can beat them. And that's the attitude that this young man from Australia has, is that if they can bleed, he can beat him. And by him getting over that deal with McGrath has helped him move on.
More problems for Grant Langston. And hopefully we'll get a chance to show that to you, as he's had another incident on the racetrack. And speaking of which, the move that Chad Reed put on Grant Langston is known commonly throughout the world of Supercross, at least to insiders, as a Rick Johnson.
Wow. I kind of like, it's good when they refer good people to me. I've been referred to when someone makes a big mistake as a Rick Johnson, but this kid is phenomenal. I mean, my hat's off to him. I'm really impressed with him, not just the way he rides, but with the way he carries himself. And I know I keep going on like I'm a big Chad Reed fan. Well, I guess I am. You know, I've had the opportunity to do interviews with him, watch him stand outside and do autographs for people, and just watch him race. He doesn't falter.
Well, if you're an admirer of talent and of good character, Chad Reed seems to have a good measure of both. With two laps to go, he's well in reach of picking up a 125 win, which would make three by non-Americans here in now 18 years of history at Daytona.
Well, it's funny that we're talking about Australians and non-Americans when we did an interview with Jimmy Pomeroy, who was the first American to really knock those doors down. And it's those kind of guys that made the sport possible for myself, Bob Hanna, Jeff Stanton, Jeremy McGrath, and now guys from other countries like Chad Reed, Stefan Roncada, Grant Langston. Is those guys lived in the back of their vans. They put up with their hard time. So a lot of the newer guys can make a lot of money and be a legitimate professional sport. You know, Roger DeCoster is now the manager of Team Suzuki, but he was one of the pioneers to come over here with CZ and live out of the back of a van with Joel Robert and really introduce motocross to America. Now, Americans have been the dominant riders for the past few years, but we're seeing a lot of Europeans come back. So I was talking to Roger earlier this morning, and this is the top off-road motorcycle championship is the Supercross championship.
Grant Langston still running in third position again. He's had a little bit of bad luck going on here. Went down when Chad Reed passed him. He was the leader of this race. The white flag is out for Reed as Langston continues to circulate the race course. And to give you an idea of how big a lead that the top three, we mentioned that there was a 21-second difference between third and fourth place. That difference now is up in the one-minute range. Grant Langston running in third position. Mike Brown second. Chad Reed, the leader, 19 seconds ahead of Brown.
If Chad Reed goes on to win this race, he will tie Ricky Carmichael for 125 East Coast. So that just shows you, the guy that we've bragged so much about, Ricky Carmichael, Chad Reed is about, if he continues this lap, he will tie the record.
Chad Reed well on his way and well inside the final lap right now as he works his way through a last couple of riders on his way to the checkered flag. Each one of them moves over respectfully, as did Keith Johnson there, and allows the man that has been the undisputed king of the 125 East class this year. This will be his fourth consecutive victory in the division.
Yeah. I mean, this is the best part of a motocross race if you're racing. Because once the checkered flag's over, it's pretty much over. But you look, he's wheeling down the start straightaway. He's just having a good time, and you get to enjoy it. You get to hear the crowd. But this is kind of an anticlimactic win for him because he's so far out in front. And sometimes people think, it's kind of a boring race. But trust me, you long for those races where you're out all by yourself and put almost the whole field a lap down.
Around the final corner, and now he coasts through the last few bumps. No need to jump him if you don't have to. He's saluting his crew on the track side, and he'll cross the finish line, joining Michelle Pichon and Ernesto Fonseca as non-Americans to win at Daytona. It is truly a global motorcycle community here today.
Times, Rolling Stone, USA Today, and critics around the country are hailing the number one movie in America. Gene Shalit says We Were Soldiers has an exemplary cast. Mel Gibson is excellent, says Richard Roper. Newsweek calls it a moving experience. 4 stars. Joel Siegel raves, it's a powerful film. Mel Gibson delivers an amazing performance, and Ebert and Roper give it 2 thumbs up. We Were Soldiers, rated R, now playing.
What is the scent of an avalanche? Smell this.
Avalanche, a refreshing new scent from Speed Stick.
Cool.
Inspired by the power of nature. Protection that smells good.
5 minutes. The era of Speed Channel has begun. Formula One continues where it has lived for the past 6 seasons. This year, Michael Schumacher, the winningest driver in Formula One history, goes for his record-tying 5th world championship. But a new challenger looms. 2000's Indy 500 winner Juan Pablo Montoya proved he could win races last year. Now he tries to prove he can win the championship. The new look of Speed. No one gets you closer.
Chad Reed and his 4-stroke Yamaha become the first to do so here at Daytona. Mike Brown on his Kawasaki second. Grant Langston, in spite of a couple of mishaps, holds on to third quite nicely. Hats off to Brandon Jessamine for fourth. And how about John Dowd? Striking a blow for the more or less senior citizens here, racing against a bunch of teenagers, getting in 7th position. Let's go downstairs to Jamie Little and Chad.
Chad, you just proved that no matter if you're racing indoors or outdoors, you are the fastest man on the fastest bike.
Yeah, Jamie, coming into this race, everybody thought that, because I haven't ridden here, I was going to struggle. And, whenever people doubt me, I normally try my hardest to, you know, try prove them wrong. And this track was everything I've been used to, you know, living in Europe last year. It was full sand, and this track was just like Europe, and I loved every bit of it. It was so fun. And so, yeah, I'm just really happy for me and the team, and I really want to thank the team, Boost Mobiles, Yamaha Troy, Scott Goggles, Cyrus Shoes, Dunlop Tires, just everybody, my girlfriend Ellie, and just for helping me out and making me, you know, four in a row.
When you first came to America, you had confidence that you would do well here, but are you surprised that you were going to do so well? You've gone 4 for 4 now?
Honestly, I'm not surprised. You know, I want to win races just as much as everybody else does, and if I don't win, I get really annoyed, and I expect to win every race I do, and, you know, I tried damn hard, so this is everything I train for, and the results speak for themselves.
All right, great job by Chad Reed. Let's go over to Greg.
Well, with Mike Brown, what a ride for you. You had him in your sights most of that race.
Yeah, I did. You know, I hung in as hard as I could. You know, I got arm pump as usual, you know, but, you know, I'm still working on it, man. This track was rough, and, you know, they rode a great race. You know, I just stayed back there and to see what happened, and, you know, I just ended up second. I didn't get what I wanted, but I survived the race.
What do you think about the whole Daytona experience?
Oh, it's good. You know, I've been coming here for a long time. It's always a good race, especially if you're in good shape, you know, and, you know, I feel like I'm in good shape. I just get my arms figured out.
Well, Mike Brown, a good second place. Jamie with third.
Grant, you know, the bad luck continues. What is your take on what happened with Chad Reed?
Well, I mean, things are starting off well, and I just seem to have this problem with arm pump, and I tightened up a little and made a mistake coming to the first turn, and he was able to cut inside of me, and he jumped across, like, into my line, and as we landed, we bumped, and I'm the one who goes down, and it's frustrating. It's really frustrating.
So it was just racing?
Yeah, I mean, it was nothing dirty on his part. He was just being aggressive. He took my line away, and we bumped, but I went down. But, you know, we managed to get a third. I'd just like to thank the team. You know, they've been behind me the whole way through all the tough time. You know, Red Bull, KTM, and all the other sponsors have been really great. I'd just like to thank them.
All right, send it back on up to you guys.
Well, our top three, a very gracious Grant Langston, but again, as Richard Petty would say, one of them racing deals. You've heard that before. You'll hear it again right here on Speed.
In a world where beauty and power reign supreme, there's only one thing
gotcha.
You can count on. For graphic powered handling. Ten. Nine. Eight. Seven. Six. Five. Four. Three.
On March 22nd, the wait is over. Blade 2, rated R, starts March 22nd.
From the makers of Tony Hawk's Pro Skater comes Sean Palmer's Pro Snowboarder, where you can trick off of everything on the mountain.
Yeah, just like in the real world.
Ride 8 different real world mountains. Choose from 10 top boarders, including Salt Lake gold medalist Ross Powers. Pull insane combos and trick off of everything.
Yeah! Everything.
Sean Palmer's Pro Snowboarder. Rated E for everyone.
This is Silverado Heavy Duty, with the most towing capacity of any heavy duty pickup. Silverado Heavy Duty. More truck. From Chevy.
Hey, tonight on Speed, it's all about CART. We've got CART qualifying at 8, then the Toyota Atlantic Series at 9:30. And I'm not going to lie to you, tonight it is a CART night. If you haven't seen CART lately, then I suggest you stick around. You will not be disappointed. Stay with us. It's all tonight on Speed.
Welcome back to Daytona. Interviews still going on for the winners in the 125 Supercross, the Daytona Supercross by Honda. And our congratulations to the winner, Chad Reed, Mike Brown, and Grant Langston, who are doing the interviews right now downstairs. Again, a nice crowd on hand. We take a look at the points here. Chad Reed has taken the whole loaf while everybody else has gotten a nice big slice here and there. You can see a 16-point advantage over Mike Brown, who finished second here today. Steve Boniface, terrible race for him, 13th position, that hurts. And Buddy Antonez, as we mentioned, was 11th, moved up to 9th by the end of the race. He's third, or fourth in points, rather. And while the 250s are getting ready and the 125s are finishing up their business, we'll take another commercial break. We'll come back. We'll talk about the fact that David Voulamon, the points leader in 250, isn't racing, and Carmichael could be the new leader.
Sport bikes. Are you worthy? Get zero down, zero interest, and zero payments on any Kawasaki vehicle until 2003.
I'm Adrian Fernandez. Check out Live Kart this Sunday on Speed.
If you
with yo-yo diets and food fads, do you need help making the right diet choices? Introducing NutriCounter, the electronic organizer that monitors and measures your food. Not just a calorie counter, it creates a program for your individual goals. Lose or gain weight, reduce cholesterol, fat, sodium, and sugar. Manage fiber, protein, and carbs. Type in your food and it displays the nutritional content and adds up your totals for the day. If you go over your goal, the line flashes. It's like having a personal diet counselor. There's over 2,000 built-in foods, including fast foods, or add your own. NutriCounter looks like a calculator, so you can discreetly use it anywhere.
I use the NutriCounter to watch my sodium intake, and I lost weight.
Call the toll-free number to find out how you can invest in NutriCounter to start enjoying a lifetime of diet success. Enjoy success the NutriCounter way. Call now.
To order your NutriCounter or for more information, call 1-800-815-9094 toll-free right now. That's 1-800-815-9094. Call now.
At Daytona International, the 250 main event riders are getting set to go. You can see that the starting lineup is not quite complete behind the gate, but this is the way they're going to line up. Tim Ferry, Travis Pastrana, and Ricky Carmichael. Pastrana had his choice, winner of the fastest heat, and Stefan Roncada making up the first four you see here.
Sebastian Tortelli, Ezra Lusk, Ernesto Fonseca, and Jeremy McGrath, all in the top 10.
We continue to look down through the starting grid, and the handsome guys behind the helmets there, Pavalny, Kyle Lewis, Keith Johnson, Jason Thomas, and Damon Huffman. There he is on his number 20 machine.
Nick Way, Heath Voss, and Nathan Ramsey coming in from the semi.
Way had some problems. Hopefully he'll be able to bounce back. Isaiah Johnson also, went down, got up. That seemed to have been the order of the day. We saw the best riders do it. We saw riders a little bit deeper in the field do it. And here are the remaining riders for the 30 bike field in the 250cc main event.
And you look at those last three, Olaf, Stiles, they all had to come from the last chance. So they've had a long day this far and it's not over. We got 20 more laps to race.
That's exactly right. And it's coming right at you. Live on Speed, the Daytona Supercross by Honda 250 main event when we come back.
What is the ultimate race place? On the weekend of April 5th through 7th, there'll be a new twist as the gladiators of the AMA Yamaha Superbike Challenge debut on California Speedway's all-new state-of-the-art motorcycle road course. Experience the speed and the fury. Order your tickets now at californiaspeedway.com or call 1-800-944-RACE. California Speedway, America's ultimate race place.
Shkla-bam!
Okay, ladies, check out my latest purchase. 100% personalized.
Hey, isn't that the Wakanachi River?
Yeah, that's the cabin we stayed at last year.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, cabins are fun. How did you afford that?
Granted, it ain't cheap, but I've been sealing a few more of the cracks in my house using great stuff. Saving money on utility bills and putting more cash in my pocket.
Great stuff. It's great.
Oh, yeah. Nachos.
Yeah, they're $1.50 right over there.
Introducing the best America Online ever, new version 7.0. It's better, faster, and easier.
It's like a click and you're connected.
7.0 is fast.
It's got all the new features. It's just so easy.
All new AOL version 7.0.
Welcome.
It's everything you love about America Online.
You've got mail.
I'm falling in love with the new features. 7.0 is the best.
America Online, new version 7.0. So easy to use, no wonder it's number one. Call 1-800-4-ONLINE. You can sign up for AOL or get a free 7.0 disc at any of these retail stores.
Once again, high above Daytona International Speedway, Rick Johnson's way too cool to be a Twitter, but I'm going to say that's what I am. As we get ready to start the 250cc main here, I mean, this is excitement of the highest order. Unfortunately, David Vuleman is not going to be competing. He was the points leader. That hands a rather easy pass, or an opportunity anyway, for Ricky Carmichael to become the new points leader after this race here at Daytona. And there is Carmichael on his number four bike. And I think maybe the rider that pulled up right next to him is the only one that might deny him a win.
Well, Pastrana has been running very, very strong. They both had the little fall down and get back up. But Carmichael needs to attack the track and not worry about David Vuleman, because even if he does win this, that's only going to give him a 5-point lead over David Vuleman. If Villeman's able to get healthy for next weekend, basically the playing ground's level again. So he can't think that, oh, the series is over. Vuleman's was smart by not racing this weekend to get himself healthy. Hopefully when he gets that CAT scan or the different x-rays, they don't find big problems and the series is done. Hopefully he can work on it, get himself ready, and be out next weekend.
What about Jeremy McGrath, the 7-time champion? Showtime today? Yes, no, maybe?
Well, Jeremy was unbelievably strong in practice. I didn't even think Ricky had anything for him, but in the heat race, it looked like he got a little bit of that arm pump again. But I know he's working with Skip Norfolk and that whole Larry Brooks and Yamaha and Bud Light team to do a lot of work. So if they made some changes and he's a little more comfortable in this main event, look for him, because he's a past winner here at Daytona.
Jeremy McGrath putting on the goggles, making his final preparations. All the riders doing the same thing. The engines are fired, and we are just about set to begin with the 250 main here at Daytona. And the winner of this race will join a very small fraternity of Daytona winners. My broadcast partner, a two-time winner here, and the men who won it more than two times are very few in number.
Yeah, there's two of them. There's Bob Hanna and also Jeff Stanton, who's won it four times. But this is the great thing about Supercross. Just like NASCAR, it's a Super Bowl out there. All the best riders in the world are lined up. But the one thing different about Supercross than NASCAR is there's not a starting grid. They all line up side by side, and may the best man win around that first turn.
It's a little like drag racing combined with because turn one and the whole shot is so important. The gates are going to go down in a moment. The flags are up. The board is up. It's sideways, and they're off. The 250cc main event. Who's going to get the whole shot? Ricky Carmichael by a mile. Turn number one.
And Travis Pastrana pulls off a good move in that first turn.
Oh, Carmichael
makes a small mistake.
Yep.
And now look at Tim Ferry on the inside. He's got the right line.
Oh, cases it.
He cases it, comes up short. Pastrana puts a wheel in on him. And now we're back to Carmichael in the lead.
Carmichael out in front, had about 3 bike length lead going into the turn. Pastrana got to it. Now Pastrana makes a mistake.
Yeah, it looks like Pastrana's a little bit tight. He needs to start breathing and start relaxing and get into his groove, because Tim Ferry has made a good move into second, but Ricky Carmichael's put about 10 bike lengths on these guys. They can't let him run away.
Tim Ferry running in second position. Carmichael is trying to run away. And so they really clearly better punch in their collective time cards and go to work on the kid from Florida.
Well, the one time that somebody gave Carmichael a hard time, he was able to pass him on the last lap, and that was David Newman in Indianapolis. So if they stay in touch with him, it might tighten Carmichael up a little bit, and hopefully they'll have a shot at him at the end.
Coming through that very difficult loop section, Carmichael looking very much in control, but what a wild start for Ricky.
Yeah, Ricky got a really good start. You watch, he comes in here, he loses the front wheel, the back end goes around the outside of the berm, but right there, the shot would have tapped him, they all would have went down. So Carmichael getting on the gas just a hair too soon, and Tim Ferry is in the lead.
While we're watching a replay, Tim Ferry goes after it. Two Florida riders, one after the other. Carmichael from Havana, Tim Ferry from Largo. And the first race back for Tim Ferry, he wants to put a big stamp on the 2002 season with a Daytona win.
Well, this doesn't happen too often where somebody can come back and pass Ricky Carmichael, so this has got to put his head a little bit. But Ferry makes a small mistake in that corner, and luckily for him, he did not stall that big four-stroke.
So Carmichael with the whole shot, Ferry coming from third to second to first. We'll take another look at the pass by Tim Ferry on Ricky Carmichael.
Well, we see Ricky, everything's looking good, comes to the inside, but then here comes Red Dog on the inside and just takes away the line from him. Gets in there, does a little block pass, no contact, but takes away the line from Carmichael, and Tim Ferry is your new leader.
Carmichael running 129s in the qualifier, running 129s in the race. Tim Ferry matching that. Actually, Carmichael's best lap time was a 131. It's Ferry that's doing the 29s, and they're side by side going through the into the second loop section, and Carmichael repasses Tim Ferry for the lead. Let's see if Ferry's got an inside move for him here. No.
Doesn't have anything for him. Carmichael just carried a little more momentum going into that section of whoops after the triple and was able to complete the pass.
Now we agreed that maybe his tip over early on was a wake-up call for Ricky Carmichael. Maybe getting passed was the wake-up call here in the main event.
Well, in that same turn where Tim Ferry passed him last time, Ricky Carmichael took a blocking line, didn't go for the faster line, took the inside, and took that passing line away from Tim Ferry.
Ricky Carmichael trying to scamper away, but Tim Ferry staying close, a couple of bike lengths behind. Daytona Supercross by Honda, being led by Honda's Ricky Carmichael.
Is over. Blade 2, rated R, starts March 22nd.
From the makers of Tony Hawk's Pro Skater comes Sean Palmer's Pro Snowboarder, where you can trick off of everything on the mountain.
Yeah, just like in the real world.
Ride 8 different real world mountains. Choose from 10 top boarders, including Salt Lake gold medalist Ross Powers. Pull insane combos and trick off of everything.
Yeah! Everything.
Sean Palmer's Pro Snowboarder. Rated E for everyone.
Kart lives on speed. The cars are tuned. The field is set. The drivers are hungry. Who'll stand on top and who'll stand aside? The Kart FedEx Championship Series, live in Monterrey, Mexico. Sunday at 4, only on speed.
At Daytona International, Travis Pastrana has thrown down a 128 lap, moved past Tim Ferry into second, and he is stalking Ricky Carmichael for the lead.
Yeah, Ricky's been running real strong and consistent out front, and Travis, with that momentum getting by Ferry, he's riding really, really hard. Hopefully he can keep his focus, because he's reeling in Ricky Carmichael, so he just got to make his move and not make it too soon. A lot of times Pastrana's been the fastest guy. Here we'll take another look at the pass on Ferry, where he has a great run at him going up to the triple, he stays a little bit lower. Notice how he absorbed it up. Now as he comes into there, he doesn't slow down as much as Ferry, getting into the whoops and then squirts by. Travis is the king of absorbing, using that long body to his advantage and not hurting him, not hurting his momentum.
Tim Ferry, very impressive though. A very impressive race so far. His first back after dealing with an injury. Now Travis Pastrana on the hunt after Ricky Carmichael. Both have fallen down, gotten back up today. And as we mentioned, it may have been a reminder to both of them, certainly to Ricky Carmichael, you've got to go out here and race the track. No David Villeman to worry about. And for Travis Pastrana, missing the last round, championship pretty much out of reach, a Daytona win would be a nice way to come back also.
Well, definitely. Carmichael wants to win down here in Florida. And he obviously is very comfortable in the sand in this type of track. He's very strong in the outdoors as well, so he's not just a supercross racer.
Very quiet upper body through that section of jumps there. We got to look at it.
He seemed to have his momentum, but notice how hard he drives. As soon as he enters the corner, even gets the bike close to going in the right direction, he is on the gas. Ricky's speed is very intense, and the way he rides right there, he reaches up, adjusting his goggles. A lot of times the riders have tear-offs on their goggles, and they'll pull them off because they'll get sand in between them. Even though Ricky's out in front, sometimes you get sand in between your tear-off shields, and what those are is little clear pieces of plastic. When you get roosted, get dirt on them, you can pull them off and you can clear one. You can see the little tabs hanging out there on the left side of his goggles. So you'll see the riders do that a couple times. They're not really waving at the crowd or giving any kind of peace sign. They're just, you know, clearing out their vision.
Lap time scrolling across the top. We mentioned Travis Pastrana did a 28, and it was a 28.9. Ricky Carmichael comes back with a 28.5, just to show who is fastest out here today. And
that's one of the hazards right there. Yep. A rider going down and getting in Ricky's way. If Ricky wasn't heads up on that, he could have very easily gotten caught up in there and put him down. But that's what happened to Travis Pastrana in the heat race. But luckily for Carmichael, it didn't happen to him here.
Mike Caton Jr. down and back up again after almost holding up the leader. And we also understand that Tim Ferry having some problems.
Well, we're six laps into the main, and Carmichael is already into lappers. So that's going to tell you how far up. By the end of this race, you know, we got 14 more laps to go. He could lap up into the top five.
Now, we mentioned about Ricky Carmichael's crash in the qualifier earlier, how he fell down, got back up, never relinquished the lead, but it may have brought, to his attention, the job at hand.
Here was the crash that he had earlier. He just lost the edge, and as it comes around, his wheel drops, and it starts to bite. It comes around on him. Luckily, when he went down, he didn't hurt himself, because every time you go down on a motorcycle, you got to remember, it's not just a small fender bender. Your body hits the ground. You're twisting your knees. You're pulling your groin. And you got your hands out to keep you from falling, you know, trying to cushion your load. So a lot of times it can come back and bite you, but fortunate for him and for Travis in the heat race, neither of them got hurt.
Jeremy McGrath, by the way, a somewhat distant fourth place. He tried to maintain contact with the leaders and wasn't able to do so. There you can see the rest of the names scrolling across the top of the screen. And Ricky Carmichael seems to have relaxed as much as anything. And now his lap times are faster than they were early in the race. He's just settled into a rhythm, and Ricky Carmichael has this race under control for now. We emphasize for now, and right now we're going to take a break.
Biggest names in motocross and off-road racing have an even bigger name under them, Suzuki. Do you want to be the next big name? Get on a Suzuki RM or DRZ today.
Behold the hot and juicy Whopper. Flame broiled, never fried. Crisp lettuce, crunchy dill pickles, onions, and red ripe tomatoes on a freshly baked bun. America's favorite burger just keeps getting better. Aren't you hungry for a Whopper now?
On March 22nd, only he can lead his old enemies.
They're no longer top of the food chain.
Our forces are ready to fight.
You've been taking orders from me.
To fight a new breed of terror.
Daywalker.
Wesley Snipes.
I do not know who you are.
Messing with!
Blade 2, rated R. Starts Friday, March 22nd.
How does lightning smell? Smell this.
Lightning. An intense new scent from Speedstick.
Nice.
Inspired by the power of nature. Protection that smells good.
Oh, that's beautiful. Oh, that's all being flying.
Look at that. This is unbelievable.
This thing is absolutely
incredible. We've got ourselves a battle here.
Stay low.
Big trouble. Doesn't get any better than this.
At Daytona International Speedway, Ricky Carmichael very much in control as he works his way through traffic. He's able to pick his line pretty much anywhere he wants to go. The Havana, Florida rider on the factory Honda doing a great job, Rick.
Well, he does, but he has to be very careful of lap riders. As he goes through them, he's cutting through them at such a rate that he comes up on guys. He could be committed in the air. Next thing you know, he's right on top of the next guy, so he has to be careful.
Looking at the best battle on the racetrack, and that's Ezra Lusk catching Jeremy McGrath. And that is the race for fourth position. McGrath force, and there's the pass.
Yeah, Jeremy got hung out there. He went out a little bit wide. If you look at Jeremy's body position, he seems to crouch a little bit forward when his arms start to get pumped. So it looks like he's continuing. He's still having that problem of arm pump, and unfortunately for him, he had a great run going here, but now he seems to be just fading back a little bit each lap.
And Sebastian Tortelli, the next one to come after Jeremy McGrath. There's Tortelli also coming back from injury.
Well, yeah, it's really good to see Tortelli coming back and putting together a real solid run, but this is what's happened to Jeremy throughout the season. He starts out strong, typically winning the heat races, being right there at the beginning of the main, but as the race goes on, and I'm telling you people, it's an unbelievable, sounds kind of simple to somebody that's never ridden arm pump, but imagine your hands, what your arm feels like when you sleep on it and it falls asleep, where you can't move your arm, you get like your arms feel numb and where you can't control them. Well, that's what happens when a rider gets arm pumping. Your hands are your connection to your motorcycle, and once you start to lose that feel and that ability to control the bike, you're going to fall back. But looking here at Sebastian Tortelli, who's now reeling in Jeremy. Jeremy just can't seem to charge because of that arm.
Like someone else's arm on your body out there. Yeah. And McGrath has been bothered by it. He says that his left arm is getting better, but his right arm still bothers him more than the left.
Yep. And as you seen early, just a second ago, that blue and yellow flag, what that's for is for the lappers so that they know the faster riders on the lead lap are coming up behind them. They call it a move over flag, but they tell you time and time again, the riders mean do not move over, hold your line.
Sebastian Tortelli, the difference in body language tells you that Tortelli's on the run and McGrath is just trying to hang on.
Yeah,
look at Sebastian Tortelli, very aggressive posture on his bike.
Yeah, Sebastian's a very strong and very physical rider, so we're going to be looking for him at the last half of the race, because when we are at the halfway point, so we got 10 more laps to go.
10 laps to go for Jeremy McGrath to try to hold off Sebastian Tortelli to salvage fifth position here. Lusk already went by him. Carmichael, Pastrana, and Tim Ferry have crossed the line, and it is Carmichael with about an 8-second lead over Pastrana, and then it is Tim Ferry about another 8 or 9 seconds back from them.
Yeah. Well, Jeremy seems to be holding on. I mean, he's definitely a champion. He's a fighter. He's not going to just roll over and give it to Tortelli, but Tortelli is slowly reeling him in.
Perhaps the pit board, as it took a while for McGrath to get around to his pit board. He saw Lusk go by. That might have kind of jarred him into the reality that, hey, maybe somebody else is coming, and his pit guy said, Tortelli's on your tail.
Well, unlike in, now Winston Cup has kicked up its pace so hard, there's not a lot of riding, but in Supercross, there is no riding, you know. What they call about, I'm just going to ride along for a while, save my tires. In Supercross, you race every lap, every turn, every jump, and every bump. So Jeremy McGrath doesn't care who's behind him, who's in front of him. He's going to race as hard as he can. And for him to succumb to the pressure by Sebastian Tortelli tells me that he's having a serious physical problem.
10 laps remain in the Supercross here at Daytona, live on Speed, where you're watching Jeremy McGrath, the seven-time Supercross champion. And I'm always reminded when I see that number seven that there are very few, if any, champions in a major motorsport series more than seven times. You know, you're talking about Dale Earnhardt, Richard Petty, in this case, Jeremy McGrath, Mike Eddy in ASA, seven-time champion. That seems to be that magic number.
Okay, well, here comes Tortelli. It is a magic number, but here comes Tortelli on the inside, makes a move, but then Jeremy goes to a little bit of resistance, but he's just not able to physically lash back at Tortelli.
You know, almost a disheartened move there by McGrath as he thought about maybe trying to dive in there and keep that pass from happening, but it didn't happen. Sebastian Tortelli moves into fifth position here at the Daytona Supercross.
Always wanted to own your own business, one with low startup fees and the potential to generate as much income as you need? Then look to Watkins, one of America's top home-based businesses for the past 134 years. With Watkins, you can work part-time and earn a full-time income with or without leaving your current job by marketing our more than 375 top-quality household products. And with a variety of starter kits to choose from, you can start working today and start earning commissions as early as tomorrow. Operators are standing by to explain how you can start earning monthly commission checks, accumulate stock appreciation rights, and begin your own home-based business with a personalized Watkins website. All with a money-back guarantee from the company that has been standing behind its products since 1868. Call now, 1-800-557-3458 for your free information packet or choice of Watkins starter kits. That's 1-800-557-3458. Call Watkins today.
Ricky Carmichael continues to lead here at Daytona International, a pretty sizable lead. And by winning this race, he will become the new points leader over David Villeman, who did not compete. The difference was a minus 20 for Carmichael coming into the race. It'll be a plus 5 going out of here if he holds on. The yellow flag is waving because number 199, Travis Pastrana, went down hard just past the start-finish line. You can see that Carmichael has slowed down just a little bit. His fourth lap was his fastest, his most recent 6 seconds slower than that. So Pastrana is down hard and out of the race. And it reminds us, and it should remind Ricky Carmichael, that you've got to keep your concentration all the time, constantly, because we've said it before, it's happened to them. You can fall down and your whole race changes in a heartbeat.
Yeah, it does. You can see how Carmichael's bouncing from side to side to side, constantly correcting his bike. It's never easy out there because you're trying to go as fast as you can and your bike's getting whipped all over the place. So you're using your body, you're using the power, you're using the brakes and the accelerator, trying to do everything you can to keep yourself moving forward and gaining time. But now he knows he has a big lead, so he's relaxing a little bit. That's where you see the 6 seconds off, because he's getting constant signals back and forth from his mechanic. He knows he has a big lead, no reason to take any chances. And the one other thing that he has to deal with is the shadows now. The sun's starting to go down, and we're starting to get a lot of shadows there where he goes in and out, where he can't see the ground as clear as he could before.
Ricky Carmichael leading very comfortably, while in the middle of this crowd of concerned people is Travis Pastrana. They're looking him over down there. You can see that there are some of his Sobi Suzuki team people and certainly friends and family members, all of whom, of course, are properly credentialed to get into that part of the racetrack. So it's a small crowd, but they're showing their concern, and we wish Travis the best. We don't know anything about his condition just yet. Carmichael, meanwhile, comfortably leading, coming up on the 79, Joe Olaf, whose fans we saw in the stands earlier. And Olaf is in 21st position right now and is probably a couple of laps down to Carmichael at this point.
Carmichael is just still running out in front. He's got a real comfortable lead. No reason to push it. No reason to take any chances. But one of the riders that I'm really happy for is Ezra Lusk. He went from sixth up to third. This will be his first podium of the year on a Kawasaki. So our hats are off to Ezra Lusk. The race is not over yet, but still, Ezra's showing a strong ride right now.
Sebastian Tortelli showing a very strong ride. In fact, he has pulled up pretty close behind Ezra Lusk. So we've got a little bit of a battle going on for third and fourth position behind Carmichael. There it is.
Okay. Ezra Lusk, and here comes Tortelli. Tortelli's showing how strong he is, that he's back in shape, he's ready to go, and his time off was well needed and well deserved. So he's making a strong comeback.
So there's Ezra Lusk and Sebastian Tortelli coming up behind him, and Tortelli's had a good run from pretty deep in the field, as Lusk did. McGrath and some of the others, of course, Pastrana out of the race now. Jeremy McGrath going from up front and slipping back. But these are two of the guys who have come forward in this race, and now they've found each other.
Ricky, and one other thing is Ricky Carmichael has just lapped 11th place with six laps to go. And here's the battle. The battle's for third position, the one space on the podium. You know, everyone talks about you got to make it to the box, and this is what these guys are working for. So if either of these two make it, and there, Lusk goes off the track. 1 second, you know, a glimpse of frustration or miscalculation, and he's off the track and now lost that podium position.
And with that, Sebastian Tortelli goes into third, but just for the moment, and now they have, they swap positions briefly, and Ezra Lusk is fighting his way back.
Well, Ezra Lusk could not make the pass because they had yellow flags out for Travis Pastrana, so he had the run on Sebastian, but he couldn't do it because if he did, he would have been docked or penalized or fined or everything or all of the above. So it was a smart move on Ezra Lusk to hold back and take another shot at Sebastian a little bit later.
Sebastian Tortelli pretty comfortably in third spot. We'll see if Ezra Lusk can get back at him. We'll take another look at it here.
Right here you see Ezra just get the grooves, and all of a sudden he starts heading for the hay bale, and he has no choice but to go off the track. And now if you go off the track, you cannot get back on the track and advance a position, but he lost a spot to Tortelli, but still he's got him in his sights, and he can come back if he's strong.
Tortelli currently in third. Tim Ferry, we haven't spoken much about him, is in second position, and here's your leader, Ricky Carmichael. For the last time we went to commercial break, Travis Pastrana left the race. Hang on, cross your fingers, we'll be right back.
Everyone makes to-do lists. Some are just more ambitious than others. Ready to make your list for 2002? Start by visiting your local Kawasaki dealer today and get zero down, zero interest, and zero payments on any Kawasaki vehicle until 2003.
So, you know that stuff I was sealing the cracks in my house with the other day?
Yeah, great stuff. You told me.
Yeah, so it lasts for years.
No kidding.
Shh. It's awesome. It's easy to use. You can seal up the whole house without even breaking a sweat. And oh man, does it ever save on the heating and AC bills? Ah, there she is.
Oh, you're actually gonna fish today?
Great stuff, it's great.
Oh yeah.
What's with this guy?
Hey, lots of lake, buddy.
Maybe he'd like to hear about the cracks in your house.
Hi everybody, I'm Dick Vitale. And this hoop season, I want you to join me and my friends from Hooters Restaurant in raising money for the V Foundation for Cancer Research, a great organization created in the memory of my buddy Jim Valvano, Jimmy V. Go to any Hooters restaurant and purchase one of my autographed basketballs. Proceeds from your purchase will fund cancer research. What a great cause. How did I do, girls? You're awesome, baby. Hey, you stole my line.
How does lightning smell? Smell this.
Lightning, an intense new scent from Speed Stick.
Nice.
Inspired by the power of nature. Protection that smells good.
Five minutes.
Mark Martin, and I feel the need for speed.
The Daytona Supercross by Honda, brought to you by Joe Rocket, Evolution of a Champion. By Yamaha, the leader in creating a lifetime of exciting and memorable experiences. By Honda, the company that defines performance in motorcycles, ATVs, and scooters. And by Kawasaki. Kawasaki, let the good times roll. Ricky Carmichael in and out of the shadows. That doesn't seem to have bothered him. He's backed his lap times off. Maybe a second a lap. You can see the average at 132. That's a 128 quick lap and a 136 this last time. So he's just easing off ever so much, Rick, knowing that if he just stays out of trouble, he's got this one in the bag.
Yeah, there's no reason for him to push it. As we, you know, we saw him pushing in the heat racing going down when he had an 11-second lead. Right now, with the shadows and the lappers and all the different things, you just want to focus on completing those lap after lap after lap.
Ricky Carmichael out in front. In second position, it is Tim Ferry. And what a great story it is for the rider of the number 15 bike here, coming back in his first race in quite a while, putting on a great show and a great performance in the qualifier, and now in the main.
Yeah, Timmy was hurt at the beginning of the year, did come back, tried to run a little bit, but found out he wasn't 100% healthy, took the rest of that time off, and now is back here at Daytona, finishing where you have to be very physical. It's a very physically demanding track, and he's showing his mettle. He's here in second place. Unbelievable ride for Tim Ferry.
Ferry in second position. Let's go downstairs right now to Greg White for a report.
Well, just a Travis Pastrana update real quick. When he crashed, he was knocked unconscious. When he came to, suffering from some sort of heat exhaustion. He's awake and he's talking to the doctors, but they still have him laying on the grass right now. They're going to stretch him on out of here, but he seems to be okay, and he should be okay in the long run. Brian?
All right, that's good news indeed for Travis Pastrana in a weekend that has been fraught with incidents for different riders, both in the road racing events and today in Supercross. Fortunately, all the Supercross guys, some of the crashes were actually almost comical in that they were able to get back up and not even lose their positions, or in Ricky Carmichael's case, the lead.
Well, that's one of the beauties of Supercross and motocross, is because you're in the dirt, so the small crashes typically don't hurt you. Now, they don't feel good, but they don't injure you. You know, like road races, when they hit the ground, it doesn't matter. When those guys go slow, they're going 80 miles an hour. So if they just tip over in a turn, they could ground off quite a bit of skin. But in Supercross, if you have a small crash, it typically doesn't hurt you too bad.
Ricky Carmichael has been pretty error-free in this race. Got the whole shot, held off Pastrana at the very start of the race. And that was quite a contrast to the whole shot that he got in his qualifier. He had to work his way through. But it just seems like whatever problems, whatever course, whatever adversity, whatever challenge you put in front of Ricky Carmichael, he rises to it.
Well, that's the definition of a champion. You know, he's not a rider that's just going to go, well, I don't like this or I don't like that, or I'm put in this situation. In the heat race, he got a bad start. He changed whatever he did, came out in this main event to win. So he's making concessions to fix whatever is wrong. If it's his riding style, if it's his motorcycle, he's not quite dialed in, or if it's his training. Whatever it takes, Ricky Carmichael is going to do, and that's why he's the number one rider today.
And he's also a pretty cool customer. Take a look at what he was doing while he made a pass for the lead. Tim Ferry.
Well, he comes up, reaches up, grabs a tear off, gets into the lead, actually pulls two tear offs. So he's so confident that he's going to be out in front and he's not going to need him anymore. He just go ahead and yanks both of them. But an unbelievable confidence that Ricky Carmichael has.
And there is the look of confidence as he is approaching the start finish line for one lap to go.
You know, it's really interesting. You know, I go on the chat rooms at supercross.com and talk to a lot of the different people. The anticipation and people going back and forth. Some people don't like Carmichael because he's very quiet, a lot like Jeff Stanton, very quiet, very confident. They think he's arrogant, but really he's shy. But it's really nice to see the people down here in Florida that just love him. They've watched him grow up from a little kid. He's still not a big guy now, but from a little guy racing 50s, and he's been dominant throughout his whole career. And he deserves all the accolade that he gets when when he's riding because he puts everything into it. It's 100% his life.
Well, he's also been dealing with something for the first time in his career, and that is people that don't like Ricky Carmichael, because I think some of them, and he thinks so too, stems from the fact that he rode for Kawasaki all his life, but they're cheering for him here, yeah, and he's waving to them back.
Yeah, and he'll be, when he wins this race, he'll be the RC will join Mike Kudrowski and Jeff Stanton as the only rider to win three Daytona Supercrosses back to back, which I only won two and it wasn't back to back, so I know how hard of a feat that is.
Winning anything here at Daytona is no easy job, and Ricky Carmichael, a measure of just how good he is the fact that at Daytona, with all the pressure, all the hype, and we're guilty of providing some of that, of course, he's able to come through and win anyway, and as you said, three in a row joins a very small fraternity.
Very, very small fraternity. Didn't work for Bob Hanna, didn't work for me or Jeremy McGrath, but Mike Kudrowski and Jeff Stanton, I got to throw props to those guys, and there he's congratulating his mechanics, showing that those guys make a big difference in his racing.
With a 12-second lead, he can afford to give a few props to those that helped him get here. So Ricky Carmichael is going to make the last lap a truly a triumphant one for him. And he's going to make sure that he thanks his fans and his crew and everybody else that has put him in this position.
This will tie him with Jeff Ward for all-time wins, and he's still coming.
20 wins for Ricky Carmichael in a fairly short, so far, 250 career. He's heading for the finish line and will take the checkered flag. He's done that already, and now he's taking his goggles off. Ricky Carmichael, it's official, the winner of the Daytona Supercross by Honda.
Tim Ferry coming in second with Ezra Luska and Sebastian Tortelli still going after it.
So Ricky Carmichael wins Daytona for the third consecutive time. He has risen to the occasion. He has also risen to the top of the points chart, which we will show you shortly. Here are the results. Carmichael, Ferry, Lusk, Tortelli, and McGrath coming in fifth position, holding on for that. How about Nate Ramsey? What a day he had. And Damon Huffman, some of the other names here on the top 10 list. What a great run, though, for Ricky Carmichael, the new points leader, three-time Daytona winner, and quite the performer here today. The rest of the results from the 250cc main event. I'd like to thank my broadcast partners, Jamie Little and Greg White downstairs, the Honorable Dave Despain, especially Rick Johnson up here in the booth, and you for joining us here on Speed. I'm Brian Drever. So long, everybody.
Ben Stiller guest stars on the season finale of Undeclared, followed by a new 24. It all starts at 8, Fox Tuesday. Imagine a world where puppets live among us.
She's quick, he does.